Okay, let's get started now then. My name is Spike Millington. I'm Vice President of the International Crane Foundation, and I will just be introducing today's panelists. But before we get started on that, there are some housekeeping notes. Very important. This From the Field webinar is sponsored by Sandy and Steve Becker, and we're very, very grateful for their sponsorship. Steve is on our board at International Crane Foundation, and Sandy and Steve are really strong supporters of the ICF program in Asia, not just in Mongolia, but also in China. And both of them have been to Mongolia, and once you've been to Mongolia, you fall in love with it. So we're very, very grateful for their support. So thanks very much, Sandy and Steve. And as we go through our webinars, if anybody's interested in sponsoring future webinars, please contact Kate at the address here, kate@savingcranes.org. Okay, the title of our presentation, our webinar, is How Can Cranes Coexist with Nomads and Livestock in Fragile Landscapes in Mongolia. So if you've tuned in for anything other than cranes and Mongolia, you're probably in the wrong webinar. But we have two fantastic presenters today. The first is Claire Morandi, who's been working at the International Crane Foundation for more than 30 years now. Much of that work has been related to Asia. She is an expert in Mongolia and Russia, and she has been to Mongolia many times working on our program there. And in addition to her work for the International Crane Foundation directly, she's also worked with the Crane Specialist Group of IUCN to develop the Crane Conservation Strategy, which was just published last year. And we are now working to translate the strategies for the individual species into long-term conservation action plans, building on that work. And that includes the conservation action plan for white-naped cranes. And Claire will give an overview of white-naped cranes through their flyways in East Asia. That will be followed by Nyimbaya Badbaya, Executive Director and Founder of the Wildlife Science and Conservation Center of Mongolia, and is also a Research Associate with ICF and has been for a long time now. WSCC is a fantastic non-governmental organization, very, very active in bird conservation, not just cranes, but also other species. But Nyimba is a real specialist in cranes. He works with not just white-naped cranes, but with demoiselle cranes, which also breed in Mongolia, and other species such as Siberian and Eurasian cranes, which do spend part of the time in Mongolia. And he has a very extensive tracking program for these white-naped cranes, and he tracks them throughout their flyway in East Asia. He's WSCC and Nyimba have a fantastic network throughout East Asia. He communicates with scientists throughout the region. And today he's going to talk specifically about the white-naped crane program that he's been leading in Mongolia. And he will talk about the cranes, the wetlands, the nomads, the Mongolia. It'll be a fantastic presentation. So first of all, what I'm going to do is hand over to Claire to start us off.
Okay, thank you, Spike. And thank you everyone for joining us in your morning or evening, wherever you are in the world. And I want to do another acknowledgement, shout out to Sandy and Steve for their generous support. Okay, before we join Nyimba on a journey through the intriguing land of Mongolia, I want to share some background on the plight of the charismatic white-naped crane that drew ICF and NIMA's organization together back in 2013. The stunning white-naped crane is perhaps my favorite of the cranes. The species migrates through two distinct flyways in East Asia. Next. The eastern population units numbers about 6,000 birds, breeds along the Russia and China-Mongolia border. Although the numbers are good, most of their former winter habitats have been lost, and they're highly concentrated at a few small wintering areas along the demilitarized zone in Korea and at Izumi in Japan. We are watchful for the future of this population as habitat is lost to rapidly developing human populations. At this point, the cranes must share these remnant habitats close to humans. Fortunately, the demilitarized zone provides an inadvertent habitat haven for the cranes, as well as the adjacent civilian controlled zone. Next. Here, the birds are concentrated at just a few sites, especially at Chorwan. Next. Here, the cranes feed on rice gleanings. Peaceful conditions are leading to commercial development and expanded human activity in the civilian control zone. We're seeing changes in agricultural land practices that have reduced the food availability for cranes. Next. To protect these sites, we work closely with a team of devoted colleagues in the Korean Crane Network. Next. From Korea, the white-naped cranes fly to Izumi, Japan, where the government provides a huge amount of grains each winter to feed up to 6,000 white-naped cranes and 14,000 hooded cranes. These high concentrations make the birds especially vulnerable to a disease outbreak. Efforts are being made to protect alternate wintering sites and promote dispersal of the birds. Next. The Western population breeds along the Russia, Mongolia, and China borders. Counts suggest that this population has declined by half to two-thirds in just 15 years. We really need to understand why this is happening and where. Migration research by our Mongolian colleagues has been providing valuable answers to these questions. Next. Each crane pair requires large areas of undisturbed wetlands to nest. The western parts of the breeding range are experiencing prolonged drought. We're in the dry portion of a 30-year climate cycle, which is exacerbated by long-term climate change. The Khurkh Valley in Mongolia is one of the few places that has reliably retained water, and studies on the unique hydrology of this site are underway. Next. We're also seeing significant changes in hydrology and loss of habitats due to water diverted to meet the demands of growing human populations. Through working with governmental agencies in China, our team has been able to allocate water to nature reserves. Next. We're seeing widespread conversion of grasslands and wetlands to agriculture, and changes in agricultural land use are reducing food availability for the cranes. Next. Dependence on agriculture increases the risk of poisoning of cranes. This can happen when the cranes accidentally eat treated seeds that's used to kill invertebrate pests, or when the cranes find and eat poison baits placed to illegally take ducks and geese for lucrative sale to restaurants. We're working with local communities to monitor and reduce the impacts. And the cranes here, we found this incident because one of the cranes was marked up in Mongolia, but fortunately the local people were very concerned and responsive. Next. Wildfires can destroy vegetative cover and actually harm nests, eggs, or young. This has largely been controlled in China. In Russia, we're working to reduce these impacts through controlled burning and developing fire breaks. Next. All of the white-naped cranes in this population concentrate at Khuiten Lake in the winter. This is arguably the most important wintering area for water birds in East Asia. The area is characterized by high summer floods that receive exposed mud flats and food in the winter. The cranes depend on the natural cycles to provide food for the cranes. ICF has collaborated with Chinese partners over 20 years to study the fragile ecology of this system. Next. Moving forward, we need to continue studies on migration routes and habitats used by cranes in this changing landscape to guide our protection efforts. Next. We will continue to provide training to the next generation of scientists and conservationists. I love this photo of a group of spirited Chinese students who spent 4 days trekking across white-naped crane breeding habitat, doing a census of cranes and studying their ecology in the Xialong wetland. NIMA's organization is one of the best organizations I know for effectively recruiting and cultivating future leaders. Next. Fragmentation of breeding habitats due to agriculture and prolonged droughts is concentrating the birds, people, and livestock within the shrinking areas of available water, creating a new set of challenges and opportunities that are the topic of our talk today. With that thought, I would like to pass you over to my colleague and valued friend, Nimba. Nimba?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Claire. Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Spike. And hello, everybody. And I'm quite privileged to be here today and to talk about what we are doing for crane conservation, especially on white-naped cranes in Mongolia. And today I will be talking about how cranes can coexist based on our many years of research and some of the activities we are doing in Mongolia. First, I would like to raise Mongolians, just in case if there are people who don't know where the country is located. We are located in the Northeast Asia. For those people living in North America, this is quite a far distance, but it's quite large country with very few people. We have only 3.5 million, but it's the 19th largest country in the world. And we have a variety of landscapes, and especially in East and Northeast Mongolia, we have quite a lot of steppe area with very nice wetlands, and that's where we have lots of cranes, especially white-necked cranes. One striking thing about Mongolia is we still have so many people living in countryside as nomadic herders. This is the lifestyle that we developed centuries ago, and it's really fascinating. You can just drive maybe 30, 40 minutes, and then you can start seeing these people and meeting and working with these people, and it's quite nice for me. I used to live and studied in US for 8 years, and then come back to Mongolia and work with among these people in living in a centuries-old lifestyle. It's actually quite a fascinating thing. My today's talk will cover a lot about nomad people of Mongolia and also this species called cranes. But before we talk cranes, I want to give you a just brief introduction about the crane species we have in Mongolia. And we have seven species of cranes in Mongolia: demoiselle crane, Siberian crane, white-necked crane, hooded crane, Eurasian crane, red crown crane, and last one is the black-necked crane. And this is the new species for birds of Mongolia. Only last summer, this summer, one individual of this crane was recorded in central part of Mongolia. The demoiselle crane is actually one of the most common species. They're basically found everywhere in Mongolia, and also if you know, they make one of the most amazing migration flying over the Himalayas to reach the wintering area in India. And they, in Mongolia, they nest very close to herders, nomads. And this is one very good reason, which is By nesting close to herders, they are basically seeking safety from mammalian predators like foxes and some other animals. And our people are so used to have this bird around. And almost everywhere in Mongolia, you will see herders, and then and there's always demoscopes, and that's kind of nice to see in Mongolia. And this is a Eurasian crane, and they are found areas in wetlands, beach, and wetlands and rivers in northern part of Mongolia. Actually, their nesting habitat is actually badly threatened with water shortages, pollution from mining, and agricultural development. Every summer, thousands of cranes from Baikal and Siberia region also come to Mongolia to spend their summertime. Our next species is a hooded crane, and it's actually non-breeding, dead passage, but the number of hooded cranes we see in summertime and during migration is actually increasing. This beautiful species photo was taken in our study site, Khurkh and Khuiten Valley. You can see five beautiful Siberian cranes, very close to nomadic herders. This species breed in high Arctic and Siberian tundra, but they are increasing in Mongolia. And before we used to see them only very few of them, but now we started seeing them quite often. And even, and especially in our study site, they're becoming a regular summer bird. This beautiful bird is the white-necked crane, and this is the one we are doing focusing on our research mostly. It's one of the very iconic crane species we have in Mongolia. Reason is the Western population of white-necked crane is actually mostly in Mongolia. And then wherever we have white-necked cranes, they are nomad people, and also the wetlands where they live is actually quite rich in other biodiversity. To some extent, in some few places, farmers and nomads, people common living alongside with the white-necked cranes. Mongolia is actually one of the very few countries where you can see and take photographs of more than three species of cranes within one frame of your camera. I took this photo of a white-necked crane, Siberian crane, and demoscope crane a few years ago in our study site in Northeast Mongolia. This is the place, this place is called Khurkh and Khuiten River Valley. And this is the place where we work on crane conservation with the International Crane Foundation. I want to briefly quickly talk about the history of ICF's connection with Mongolia. Back in 1991, two Mongolian biologists, Dr. Bold and Dr. Tsvemetak, visited ICF and stayed there for a couple of weeks. Dr. Tsven is the man with the yellow jacket. That was the time when Mongolia was just transitioning from closed communist system to more open free market society. They were the very first Mongolian biologists visiting a Western country. Since then, they kept the connection with ICF and did many fantastic jobs on crane conservation and research in Mongolia. Dr. Tsveng is still working on cranes with his and did his PhD thesis on cranes of Mongolia. Today, he is one of the core staff working on cranes with ICF. And together with ICF and China, researchers from China and Mongolia and Russia, they did one amazing job, which is establishment of the Dauri International Protected Area for crane conservation. It's a big network of crane network sites and protected areas on the border between three countries. It's the largest crane conservation area in Northeast Asia, including several threatened species like Siberian cranes and other species. Our current project with ICF actually started in 2012 when George Archibald, ICF's co-founder, visited Mongolia with several of ICF supporters. We visited many places in Northeast Mongolia where white-tailed cranes nest, and we surveyed and we did counting of breeding pairs, and we visited towns and local schools, gave lectures about cranes and crane conservation. And we actually covered in almost the entire east northeastern Mongolia to see, assess the situation of white-tailed cranes in Mongolia. During this expedition, we basically identified what needs to be done for protection of cranes and their habitat in Mongolia. Since this, our project has progressed a lot, and we did so much work, especially on white-tailed cranes in Mongolia. Using this opportunity, I would like to thank ICF supporters and our donors for helping us and supporting our project in Mongolia. Our crane work is focused in the valleys of Khurkh and Khuiten river valleys, rivers. It's a beautiful place with a lot of interesting wetland complexes. This place is called the crane capital of Mongolia because we have six species of cranes breeding, summering, and also migrating through this area. It has all these important international conservation designations, such as Ramsar site, important bird area, and also East Asian flyway network site. However, it was not protected area until recently. Thanks to our project with ICF, this place is now a national level nature reserve. Khurkh and Khuiten river valley supports one of the highest density of breeding white-tailed cranes and demersal crane pairs. Also, every wetlands you can see this kind of photo, and you will find cranes nesting on those small lakes and wetlands. This is the one of the places I love the most. I have traveled and worked almost everywhere in Mongolia, studying birds and mammals and wildlife. But as soon as I arrive in this area, I find peace. I really could spend lots of time working here with cranes and people. And this is such a beautiful place. I really encourage everybody to visit this place. Also during spring and autumn migration, this place has supports hundreds of thousands of cranes. In this photo, you can see two species of cranes, white-necked and also demoiselle cranes. Here, cranes in this area, they live, share and wetlands with nomads and their livestock. Herders in this area have horses, cattle, sheep, and goat. There's no pigs, no chicken farms in this area. You might be wondering why there's no pigs and chickens, two of the most common domesticated animals in the world. Well, Mongolian nomads move quite often, so pigs and chickens are not very ideal to have in this kind of constantly moving situation. That's why they don't have chickens and pigs. They only have those big animals, like horses, cattle, and sheep, etc. These livestock are the herders' main income sources. That means when they have more animals, that means they can make more money, so they can afford things like buying things, more stuff, and also sending kids to schools like that. Unfortunately, the livestock in Mongolia is increasing. Now we have over 66 million livestock in Mongolia. And one hand, it's actually good for the herders, so they can earn more money to support their livelihood. But on the other hand, actually, it's really impacting our ecosystem, especially our wetland ecosystem is really becoming fragile. So wetlands, permafrost is the core habitat for white-tailed cranes. Here in this photo, you see hummocks, wetlands, and some wild livestock. Before, in this area, we used to have 16 small wetlands, and every single one of them had breeding white-tailed cranes. But now, only two of them left. But the why is because the livestock is basically taking over these wetlands and causing water shortages. This photo on left is, you see hummocks and some nice wetland grasses. Underneath these hummocks, we have a peat layer, and then underneath the peat layer, we have a permafrost layer. So those are things that really keeps the water table high up close to the water surface. Basically, they were the lifeline of these small wetlands where our cranes nest. But now you see these tracks, lots of tracks, and also some fragmented peats. And those are caused by big animals. They every day they go between these water holes and home, and that's why this is happening. And because of this constant grazing problem, and peat layer is basically getting destroyed, fragmented, and there's lots of cracks. And through this crack, and the soil moisture gets lost, and evaporation rate is increasing, and it's eventually basically losing heat and down to the permafrost, and that means we have this risk of losing all the permafrost layers, which means it will be really bad for the cranes in the future. And it will be not just bad for cranes, it will be also bad for the livestock and also people's living in this area. So this is the concern for us, and really we need to think about how cranes and livestock and people can coexist on this fragile landscape. So we have to work with people, especially local communities and local authorities. So we have started doing many studies on how this livestock is impacting our grassland, especially wetland areas. So we established these two livestock closures in our study site. So this is what happens. When you remove the livestock pressure from the area, the grass condition recovers, and we started seeing more forest conditions better, and also plant and insect diversity is increasing. Because when you have very short grass, the insects are basically insect diversity becomes very low, which means insects are one of the main food for cranes, and not just cranes, for other bird species. And also the livestock, they need more grass and healthy grass. So when we show these photos to local authorities and local people, they started realizing, but we still have this system. In Mongolian tradition, our livestock is actually free ranging. That means we don't have any fence around our wetlands. That means our wetlands are so fragile and vulnerable from grazing animals. And also with one of the big threats is when we have so many people and livestock around, the disturbance to nesting cranes becomes so intense. You can see this horse is basically approach the crane nest and sniffing this crane eggs. And eventually this cranes abandoned its nest. And then we have cranes trying its best to keep incubating, even though so many big horses around it within meters of reach. And then on top of that, we have so many dogs now around, because every these herder family have guard dogs to keep wolves and foxes evaded animals. Nomadic people in Mongolian steppe, they don't use fences. So basically, their livestock is vulnerable from predators like wolves. So dogs are the only way to keep wolves away from such kind of a threat. So after studying, spending several years of research, we found out that what are the main threats to cranes and their habitat in the Khurkh and Khuiten river valleys. So these are main threats we have. Wetland loss due to poor livestock grazing management and direct nest destruction by horses and cattle, and excessive removal of grass forage by livestock, and wetland loss due to climate warming, and also lack of data to support decision making. As you may see here, almost every major threat is linked to herders and their livestock, except climate warming. This really makes us think again, how do we save cranes? How do we ensure cranes can coexist with nomads and other animals? So after studying the ecology of cranes, we learned that we are still far from to understand the whole picture. Understanding the coexistence of cranes and nomads is not an easy task at all, because it involves both biological and social, and their interaction, and plus climate change, as you can see in this slide. So our project is basically progressing a lot and to try to capture what's best to ensure the crane conservation in Mongolia. It's not an easy, and it requires lots of partnership and also lots of effort from our side. And these are our collaborators in working in this area. I'm really thankful for them and their support in addition to our people. So what are we learning and how to apply to crane conservation and land management? Now our focus is becoming, our project is focusing on securing their habitat. If we can secure their habitat integrity, then biodiversity will be safe and cranes will be safe, their habitat will be safe, and most importantly, people will also be happy and the livestock will be also, farmland also can stay there for supporting their livelihood. So all this work is really about how to keep healthy wetlands. Mongolia is very unique compared to other countries, especially developed countries and Western developed countries, because our livestock basically can roam freely wherever they want to. And that really puts the cranes in a very fragile situations. So how do we do it? We need to make the local community to understand how fragile is the wetland ecosystem where they live and why it's important to help those threatened species of cranes that come to this area seeking for shelter and food to survive. It's really partially, it's an important conservation work for us to make sure the communities are on our side. So this is the photo we used to when we talk to local communities. And this image shows some permafrost underneath this wetland. Those dark brown is those ones of the ice and core underneath the wetland, and the thin green layers on top of that, this reddish layers are the peatlands. So peat layer basically protects underlying permafrost. And if we lose the peat, then permafrost is loose and then all the water table will go down. That means this whole area will be in drought condition, and that will be no good for livestock, people, and cranes. So when we talk about this to people, some people understand, some people it takes a lot of time for them to understand. But it's still for people, it's very difficult for them and what to do with the large number of livestock. So we need to really develop very good livestock regime management. This is the only way we can save the permafrost and peatlands, which is the fundamental ecosystem services for cranes and people living in this area. So our work is now, large parts of our work is now focused on educating local communities and authorities about why we are telling them all about this importance of wetland conservation. So this is how we work in Mongolia. So now we are working with local community. We established a crane festival using this crane festival. We increasing our interaction with local communities. This really helps us to make more interaction, close interaction with the herders and the local communities. And using this, we basically talk with herders about the importance of keeping the crane habitat for everybody's benefit. During the festival, we organize many kinds of activities focused on environmental education for kids. We hope if we can change the minds of younger generation, help them to become a more environmentally conscious generation, it will greatly benefit the white-necked cranes and the other species and eventually the livelihood of themselves as a local community. Here you can see some of the photos taken during this crane festival. These are kids, school kids dressed in costumes of whitening cranes, and they do this very beautiful dances, basically showing how cranes live and what kind of threats they have and how they can solve this problem. So by encouraging kids to participate in our activities, this really helps us to reach out to more people, and kids are one of the best messengers of crane, not just crane, but wildlife conservation. So there's so much interactions we do with kids and local people during this festival, including chances of people interact with others. Here in this photo, you see two ICF supporters interacting with local women and kids in traditional costumes. So the International Crane Foundation supporters visit Mongolia and with George and attended our crane festivals every year. It is really nice to see them visiting us, and also it's also a good opportunity for them to learn so much from us. Also, it's important for local community to interact with the visitors. And sometimes it really helps them why all these people are paying attention. And eventually it helps them to understand the importance of crane conservation and crane conservation internationally. And they even sometimes make it, they become very proud of having this beautiful bird around. We also organize lots of trainings targeting local kids and local people. And every once a while, we organize these special workshops for school kids. And a few years ago, we brought this talented kids from every school where our project reaches. And basically, they are kids from areas with where white-necked cranes nest. So we brought them to our study site and we gave them hands-on training. We gave them lectures, also we brought them down to the wetlands and we collected insects, watched cranes and watched the collected plants and basically explained how the whole ecosystem works and how this whole ecosystem supports not just cranes and also their people, herders and livestock. And this was really actually amazing training. I had never seen such a productive training in Mongolia, because we do lots of trainings, but this was one of the best ones because you can see these changes of attitude of these kids within a few days. And they're becoming from regular school kids to craniacs. And we asked them, we asked these kids when they go back, they provide same training to other kids. So hopefully these few selected kids will becoming our local trainers in their respected hometown. So this is one of the activities and really working really well in our study site. Also, we are working with women in our study sites, and because women, herder women, they stay home, raise kids, and they do lots of household works. But when you engage, start engaging them, and this is very effective way to convince the local communities. And also, it's a very easy way. It's one of the easiest way to make sure the communities are on our side to protect cranes and wetlands. Here we brought a group of women to our site, and we provided their training to make handicrafts using sheep wool. And they made this, all those beautiful products using sheep wool. Sheep wool is basically one of the very common natural materials they can find at home. And actually, you might see some of these products at the ICF's gift shop. Those products on our right, left, right hand sides are Christmas tree decorations. And you might see a few of them in ICF and Crane gift shop. So this is using these connections, we are trying to change the perceptions and minds of communities and make training them more environmentally conscious. So they will become as a Crane protectors and also help us to establish more and better grazing and control system for livestock in our impact lives in our study sites. Of course, to make sure do our work, it takes a lot of human effort. And our organization has several very dedicated people work on cranes, but it's the younger generation, younger professionals who really helps us a lot to achieve all our work. So every year we do lots of trainings, and thanks to the support from US Forest Service and also ICF, we do specialized trainings focused on wetlands conservation research and also wildlife. And also our last training was about doing some socioeconomic studies and also using the data to apply for socioeconomic management perspectives. This really helps us to achieve our goals. And our project is now doing many types of activities in the region. And also we share our experiences with our colleagues who work on same species and same habitat in Northeast Asia. Here on this photo, you can see our colleagues visited us from all countries, every country in Northeast Asia. We even had delegates, colleagues from North Korea a few years ago to learn from our experiences. And also we visit other countries too. In 2016, we organized an international workshop on white-tailed cranes in Mongolia. And this was actually a very good opportunity for us to learn from others' experiences and also share our experiences. And really living, securing this habitat is now really becoming working with herders and make sure cranes and herders can understand and can appreciate each other's benefit. Our project's biggest achievement was the designation of this area as a national level nature reserve by the Mongolian government in 2020. So this is really gives us this huge encouragement and really gives us this feeling, awesome feeling of what we are doing is actually quite important. And really gives us this more forward-thinking opportunities. But of course, much work still lies ahead. And there are so many things that we want to do here. Like one of the most important thing is, first, of course, we need a very good management plan for this park, new park. And second, we need to develop some sorts of better grazing schemes that would take wildlife conservation in account. Because we really need to reduce the livestock pressure on our fragile wetlands. But in Mongolia, our livestock grazing management is really, really poor. So using cranes is actually gives us a good opportunity to develop a good wildlife management system in Mongolia. And actually, if we can develop such a good system in this area, there's a chance we might apply for the benefit of wildlife in other regions of Mongolia. With this, I would like to end my presentation, giving you some time for questions and answers. But before I do, I would like to thank all the ICF members and supporters, and especially people listed on the screen. There's so many people helping us. Thanks to your support, we couldn't have achieved so many things here in Mongolia, especially designation of establishing this whole new nature reserve. It takes a lot of effort from all of us. So thank you again for your support, continued support. And this is our stuff. And my thanks is basically, I'm saying this on behalf of all our staff in Mongolia working on wetland plant conservation in Mongolia. And if you would like to contact us and also ICF directly, and that will be very much appreciated. And thank you very much. And yes.
Wow, thanks a lot, Yimba. Thanks a lot,
Claire. And again, thank you.
And yeah, that was a fantastic presentation. It really makes me want to go back to Mongolia. You know, I've been lucky enough to go one time to this site, and it really is as beautiful as it looks. It's just fantastic. And this would be a good time to go. I think social distancing would be pretty easy out there. So now we have question and
especially in winter.
So now we have some questions. So I'm going to actually we have lots of questions. Okay. But first I wanted to address a question to Claire. And you mentioned that this population of white-naped cranes is actually declining in this flyway. Do you have any idea of where in the flyway or why in the flyway? And then for Nyimba, how is the population doing at your site in the river valleys? Is it stable or is it declining there?
Okay, I'll go first.
Okay.
The true answer is we don't know enough on where we're losing the birds. And that's really one of our key goals. They could be a long migration. They have very few places to stop, and they have some long stretches they have to fly without food. It could be at those stopover sites. It could also be on the wintering grounds at Poyang. We wonder about the poisoning. We don't know that that's a problem, but it's really something that we need to look at a little bit more. And I'm very excited about the team we have developing in China and the collaboration that's stepping up. So hopefully in the next few years, we'll be able to answer that more directly. Nimba, your response?
Okay, the cranes in Mongolia, in our study site is actually doing okay. And the number of breeding pairs are actually stable. But the breeding success is actually declining a bit. Because the cranes are very territorial, actually. And even though they lose their old brood, they keep their territory and they come back next year and breed again. So because that's why the cranes, number of breeding pairs adults seems like stable, but it's the survival of young's eggs and chicks are becoming a big concern for us. As I showed you before, we have this livestock disturbing the nesting, incubating cranes, and dogs are becoming problems. So if we can reduce those threats, I hope the success of incubation nesting will become better, and that's what we are hoping to do. We are doing lots of work with the herders, asking them to keep their dogs chained during incubation period, so cranes can peacefully keep incubating and raise their chicks. After the chicks becomes a bit bigger, then dogs can basically go whenever they want to. So this is one of the important part of our project. And we're having this campaign called the Chain the Dogs. And it's going to take several more years, because until every single family in our studies has absorbed this and understands this. And actually dogs in Mongolia, they don't get chained all the time. Only some big aggressive ones are chained, but the rest of dogs, they can just go on their own. So still we have to do a lot, and it's a really conservation work. It really takes persistent and many years of effort to achieve some success. But we are getting there, we are on the right track now.
Okay, thanks, Jim. But yeah, I really hope we can get the dog situation under control. It's a problem for other cranes in other areas too. Okay, the next questions are about the peat and the permafrost. This was fascinating to hear about this. And so we have a couple of questions. The first one is, how does climate change affect the peat and the permafrost layers? And what can we do to mitigate the impacts of climate change on those fragile ecosystems? So those are very broad questions, but I think this whole issue of the permafrost and the melting of the permafrost is really a very critical one. So what's your opinion on that, Nyimba?
Because this permafrost thing is actually becoming very and more interesting to us. When our project started, we basically didn't know much about permafrost issue. But now we realize that this is actually the core of our conservation project. If permafrost is safe, everybody on top of this should be fine. In generally, climate change is the main cause of permafrost melting. But in Mongolian situation, we have overgrazing issue almost everywhere in Mongolia now. When too much grazing happens, it reduces the grass condition on top of the soil. So when the better the grass condition is, more permafrost is protected. So when grass is removed and the topsoil becomes warmer, and that's why permafrost becomes, there's a place also called active layer. It's basically the layer between permafrost and on topsoil. When this active layer becomes thicker, which means warmer, and it's really bad. And the short term, you will see a certain increase of water and wetlands everywhere. Then once they finish the dry now, then it will be a complete disaster. So we are really trying to educate people about the importance of permafrost. And then to keep permafrost, what needs to be done is basically to control the livestock grazing problem. And that means we really need a governing force, a strong and grazing management system. Our current project is actually becoming a very important project in Mongolia to contribute the development of a good system here in Mongolia. So really, we need to keep, if we can keep the grass condition healthy, that's the key to save permafrost and peats. Does that answer the question?
Sorry. Yeah, thanks a lot, Nyimba. So the next questions are actually related to that, and they're about the livestock and the overgrazing. So You showed the slides of the livestock exclosures where livestock is not allowed in and the grass really grew. Do the nomadic people that you're working with accept the fact that you could use exclosures or rotating grazing to allow recovery of the grass? And another question is, are you working with any other projects that are attempting to reduce overgrazing? And in the new National Nature Reserve, are there any measures for control or exclusion of livestock? How does the new status actually affect the grazing communities?
Well, there are several projects using exclosures to show grazing impact. Our project is on wetlands, and really when you do this in wetland areas, and this, the changes, dynamics of grass condition, diversity on top of it is really dynamic, really sharp. You can see it within a few months, a year. And people, actually Mongolian nomads, people are quite friendly, and they really lets us do this kind of research freely on the land. And when we bring them to this area and show them this is what's happening when you have this constant grazing in the same area again and again. Traditionally, in Mongolia, we didn't have this much livestock. So traditionally, when people have fewer animals, they also, when they move around, so it was basically they were doing this very smart rotation system to use the pasture land. So there was basically no impact whatsoever on the grazing land. But now the problem is because of we just have too many animals. So it's a really it's a really uphill battle. When you have heard these people have so many animals, it becomes really difficult for them to move around constantly. Because when you move from this place to another one, then there's another family with also large herd number of animals. So there's really goose grazing areas becoming less and less, and they're just livestock is just very too many. And now there's a big competition for grazing areas among herders themselves. So it's really, we are now in a very new kind of new situations. And the only way to get away from this situation is herders really need understand the situation and they change the way they herd their animals. They really need to use the old grazing area rotation system. They need fewer animals with them bigger, more cashmere or meat yields. It's people are just going after numbers. They really want to raise more and more animals. That's not the right way. They need to have a few. So, we are working with the other conservation organizations, try to get out these messages, because this is the problem not happening, not just to cranes. This is the problem, grazing problem is happening to almost every endangered species in Mongolia, regardless of their habitat type. And even in high mountains, we have grazing problem and conflict with the wildlife such as snow leopards and ibex and wild sheep. In Eastern Mongolia, we have also grazing problem conflicting with the Mongolian gazelles. They have huge herds, but now large number of livestock is competing for grazing area. So all this in conservation organizations are now working together to solve this issue, but it's really, we need to basically at the end, we are kind of changing the way people live and used to live in this area. So it's not an easy task.
Okay, thanks, Nyumba. Actually, we're out of time now. I hope that the new status of the area as a nature reserve, and the fact that your organization, WSCC, will be helping managing that, will help come up with some solutions for these very difficult problems. But we'll remain optimistic about it. It's such a beautiful area. For other people who put questions, we haven't had time to get to all of them. We will respond to you with answers to those questions, and we have a list of all the participants. So thank you very much for those.
Spike?
Yeah.
I just want to pipe in. I'm not sure that we're going to be able to retain the questions after that. And there's some fabulous questions there. We had time to get to. So if you don't get a reply, if you email, there's a general ICF number, but mirandi@savinggreens.org. We'll make sure you get a reply.
Yeah, that's right. So there will be a recording, and so that will go to all the participants. So feel free to email back with those questions. So yeah, they are very fascinating questions. There's just so many of them. Okay, thanks very much, Claire. Thanks very much, Nyimba. We have next slide. Thanks very much, Sandy and Steve. Much appreciated. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. Next slide. Next week, we have another webinar on Thursday. It's at 11 a.m. Here in Wisconsin time. So don't tune in at 7 p.m. like this one. It's 11 a.m. in the morning. It's called The Long and Winding Roads That Lead to Portraying Cranes. It's a very different webinar from this. It's by graphic artist and sculptor Kim Russell, working with our own visitor program manager, Cully Shelton. It'll be a fantastic one. You can see from this picture here the kind of thing that's going to be discussed. So for those of an artistic mind, and actually anybody who loves cranes, please tune in next week. Nyimba? One more. And finally, you know, all this work that ICF is doing with Nyimba, Claire, and all our other programs and colleagues is because of you, and because we're a donation-based organization. And the way you can help us, if you're not a member, please become a member of the International Crane Foundation. If you're a member, or even if you're not, please also consider making a gift, and all your donations will be going to field projects such as Nyimba's wonderful project in Mongolia. And that's all we have time for now, I'm afraid. We went over a little bit, but thanks everybody for participating, and we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Nyimba. Thanks, Claire.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody, for listening and attending, and Again, we will do our best for cranes and their habitat protection in Mongolia. And also, again, if you would like to support our work, please contact ICF and us. And thank you again.
Bye, Flat.